Hello, StockCharts users. My name is Tyler Wood. I'm a CMT charter holder. And today we're going to be talking a little bit about the concept of momentum. Joining me today is Alex Cole, creator of the GoNoGo Charts. How are you doing today, my friend?
Oh, I'm ready to go. Feeling good.
Fantastic. So if you're familiar with GoNoGo Charts, you understand that one of the core concepts we talk about over and over again is the idea of a repeatable process. Whatever your discipline is, it might not be perfect, but if you do it consistently throughout multiple market regimes, you have a much better chance of getting those consistent returns and avoiding some of the emotional pitfalls and the behavioral biases that govern all of us as investors. So, Alex, let's dive in and talk just at a high level about the concept of momentum.
I think it's important to note that the very first place you're going to go after getting an understanding of trend identification is momentum analysis. That's really what gives us a sense of the strength of any movement that we're seeing in price. We like to talk about it measuring the velocity of price change, and I think that's how you want to think about it. And so we can look for areas of extreme price swings when price has moved really quickly in one direction or another, and we can make a decision then, should it pull back? Or are we looking at the start of something really strong in that direction? And that then, of course, hints at the use of perhaps these oscillators in trending environments, not just mean reversion, as we were taught from the textbooks. But when you add these indicators to a chart, like we saw with trend identification, there's a lot of these oscillators that try to attack momentum in a slightly different way, which is very useful. We end up with a chart that becomes more complicated. And if you think about adding three or four panels to our trend identification process that we've talked about before, you're really then looking at a overwhelming chart, and you're having almost an impossible task of trying to look at price and important levels on the price panel.
Now, the important thing to think about is that these are forward-looking indicators, right? So from our trend identification, we know that's going to be a lagging concept, right? We have to establish the trend before we can identify it. So these momentum oscillators working hand in hand with our trend identification can really improve our entry and exit signals. We're going to talk about a few. We might not cover your favorite, but just for a little broader understanding of the differentiation between multiple momentum oscillators, why don't we start, Alex, with just our first example?
Yep. So this is Stochastics. And of course, Stochastics was developed in the 50s by George Lane. And Stochastics is hugely popular. We see it on charts everywhere. And what makes Stochastics interesting in its calculation is that it takes the current closing price and compares it to the range of closing prices. You know, whatever look back you use, you know, you can set the defaults or you can tweak them. But think about what kind of stochastics value you're going to get if the current price is at the high of that range. If your current price is higher than any of the other prices in that range, then we're going to get a very high reading for stochastics. And that tells us that momentum is strong. Now, in the construction of stochastics, we've got two lines, the percent K and the percent D. And now we can increase the number of the lines with stochastics by continued smoothing. We have sometimes a slower D line, but the two original lines are the K and D, and K being the fastest. K is the original stochastics line. Percent D is a smoothing of that line. And that gives us crossovers. And that's what we can use then for that traditional reading to get signals when we've got the faster K line crossing up over the slower D line. We might consider that a buy or an increasing momentum situation. Now, along with all of the other indicators that we're going to look at, we're going to see overbought and oversold levels. And that tells us when these momentum has swung to extremes. With stochastics, those are typically set at 80 and 20, but that's not something that can't be adjusted either. One thing to note is that these lines move very, very fast. So you can see that they're quickly chopping around within that range. And when they get above and below those values, that doesn't always mean it's a reason to buy or sell. It just means that we have elevated momentum, fast moving security prices.
Absolutely. Let's talk about another one, perhaps familiar to most of you, the RSI, Relative Strength Index. Not to be confused with the concept of relative strength, comparing one security or asset class against another. Now, this was introduced by Wells Wilder in 1978. And just think back for a second about what the U.S. equities markets were doing throughout the 1970s. We had a very difficult range-bound bear market. And so that concept of overbought and oversold became very important for investment managers to understand areas of perhaps trend reversal within that range-bound space. As we think about applying concepts like RSI in trending securities, we don't want to fall prey to the idea that an overbought signal means sell and an oversold signal means buy. That wasn't the original intent of Wells Wilder and others. Just a point of differentiation, comparing RSI to stochastics, you can see that there's only one value, a single line. And that's going to change in reaction to the latest price bar. So RSI is constructed by looking at a computation in which average gains are divided by average losses over a specified lookback period. Typically, that's 14 days or weeks or minutes, whatever's on your chart and your time horizon. Now, you're going to see a higher RSI reading when recent price action has been dominated to the upside. So again, we're capturing investor behavior with a new derivative tool, capturing, you know, the power of buyers over sellers or vice versa. RSI is capturing that market behavior to help us identify those overbought and oversold conditions that I mentioned, hoping to predict or at least give us a leading indication of trend exhaustion or trend expansion. This is another range-bound oscillator. Again, this is a very subjective portion of these momentum oscillators that you have to decide whether above 70 or below 30, as is sort of the standard interpretation of RSI, constitutes overbought or oversold. But for the investor or the trader, does 69 count as overbought? How different is that from 71? And again, there's an interpretive method to all of these tools. Alex, let's do another one.
So the next one we're going to look at is the money flow index. And money flow, this one differentiates itself by including volume in the calculation. So money flow, the index will separate out up days and down days, and then it will assign the volume to those days. And so you get a sense of positive money flow and negative money flow. When the line is rising, we are able to say that there's volume coming in on those up movements that's driving that indicator higher. So we can use this just like we did with all of these other indicators to get a sense of how fast or how quickly price is moving and how much market participation is behind that. That's the added volume piece. Now, on the last slide, we had the bullet point of divergence, and we're really going to go into it here. With so many of these oscillators, divergence is a very important concept. The idea is that when something is happening in price, we want to see that confirmed by the lower panel. If it isn't confirmed, then we call that divergence. And so this, here's an example on the chart, price making higher highs, but the oscillator below making lower highs. And so that's non-confirming. And in this case, given that it's the money flow index, we can sort of suggest that there's more volume on down days than up days. So that's an interesting added piece to the analysis.
Absolutely. We want to think about these momentum oscillators in their own right, the information that they provide, but that interplay between trend and momentum is critically important. Now, moving to perhaps the most simple of all would be a rate of change, right? So we can look at just simple price moves, measuring momentum by looking at the percentage change in price between the current bar and a specified lookback period. Now, unlike all of the other oscillators that we've talked about so far, the rate of change indicator plots a line starting centrally at zero, and it's going to move above and below. Now, we know with an unbounded oscillator like rate of change, those values, you know, from positive 100 to negative 100, we can have securities that move well outside those bounds that thus kind of distorts what is a typical range. So just for an example, for those of you who participated in the meme stock mania or even watched from the sidelines in awe, GameStop had a rate of change that reached 1,800 during that historic 2021 short squeeze. So just keep in mind that with an unbounded oscillator, there's room for that to move that can then distort the readings of your lookback period. But very simply, a rising rate of change above the zero line is going to help us confirm that uptrend we're seeing in price action. And then a falling rate of change below the zero line is going to confirm our downtrends. Now, Alex just talked about the concept of divergence, which is very powerful. And we can look at that interplay between trend and momentum for important signals of exhaustion or expansion. However, this is not an infallible tool. So we can see a bearish divergence, right? We have a lower high in the rate of change as price makes a higher high, but that does not precede a falling price, right? Rate of change came back up and supported this this higher move. So it's just a word of caution about looking for those divergences. That's not necessarily a trade signal, but it's giving us some context. It helps us sharpen our pencil, think about our risk management for a trend that might be reaching a period of exhaustion. Alex, let's do our final one with the commodity channel index.
Yeah, the last one we're going to look at today, the commodity channel index takes the price and compares it to its historical average. So a lot of people will do this visually by looking at how far price has moved from a simple moving average on the chart. Well, this oscillator shows you in the lower panel exactly how extreme those moves have been. Now, what's interesting here is that, of course, this like ROC is unbounded. So you can have the commodity channel index readings, you know, move up, like you said, perhaps not as far as 1,800, but even on this chart of the S&P, you can see it move up into the 200s and even close to 300. And so putting these overbought and oversold levels on this oscillator becomes a little bit tricky and a little subjective and even arbitrary. So you want to keep that in mind when you're looking at an unbounded index. But again, you can use the concept of divergence to identify moments where price is rising, but there's not as much momentum or enthusiasm on those moves. But a good one, this, because it gives you, like I said, that sense of how far away has price moved from its average. And that gives us that sense of whether or not perhaps something is overextended, whether it's likely to pull back towards that mean. You know, it gives you a lot of important information.
Absolutely. So as we wrap up this session, let's just think about what our chart is going to look like when we incorporate these multiple momentum tools. Again, coming back to that trend identification session that you've probably already watched, we really want to capture the checklist. We want the weight of the evidence, multiple indicators confirming what we're seeing. And as you can see, there's a lot of differentiation between these incredible tools that the men and women of Wall Street have innovated and created and refined for us. I don't want anybody to walk away from this presentation thinking that Alex and I don't appreciate the work of George Lane and Wells Wilder, as well as the interpretive work of Andrew Cardwell and Connie Brown, how we can use these tools in a practical and responsible way. But for trading strategies that are going to employ multiple momentum indicators, you start to layer in these panels below price and just take a look at what the S&P 500 looks like in this tiny shrunken panel as we add more and more indicators to our chart. We can't see price action. We cannot differentiate important areas of support and resistance or do any of our other analysis. And we want to capture all of the information from these incredible tools without cluttering our chart. And we also talked about how some of these might be a bit redundant. Others are going to be contradictory. So where is the investor left in terms of trade decisions if you have multiple tools that might be confirming or denying each other's signal? Yeah. Here comes the solution.
Yeah, and so this is why we created the GoNoGo Oscillator. We know that momentum goes hand in hand with trend identification. And using the GoNoGo Oscillator, we hope will help us understand the velocity of price change rather than complicate our decision making. So looking at the GoNoGo Oscillator, we've taken the same approach where we've blended those foundational concepts and the most robust momentum tools into one oscillator that gives us the information that we need about the strength of a security's price. We know that increasing momentum can confirm a trend in price. We know that decreasing momentum can be a leading indication, like you talked about at the beginning, and that could lead to a potential perhaps for some sort of reversal or a pullback. So we get that information out of the oscillator. We can still identify the extremes of overbought and oversold. In our case, we've got our oscillator on a range between -6 and +6. So it's a simple range of understanding whether momentum is positive or negative. When the oscillator crosses above 5, we'd consider that overbought. And you can see how that those areas of overbought line up with peaks in price. Areas of oversold would be at 5 or below, -5 or below. And you can see how those will often line up with the troughs in price. And of course, importantly, we can also see divergence because we have higher highs in price here, lower highs in the oscillator. The first example on the left is lower lows in price, but with higher lows in the oscillator. And so we get all of the information that we want out of our momentum tools, but hopefully, as you can see, without clouding the chart, because we leave that price panel large on the top half.
And that idea of combining multiple momentum oscillators, getting that weight of the evidence, but without cluttering our chart, is sort of the trademark or hallmark of GoNoGo Charts. We want to capture that very important information using multiple tools, but we don't want to clutter what we're seeing from a data visualization perspective. And finally, the last thing that we've incorporated into this oscillator, as we saw with the money flow index, a volume-weighted RSI, as it's often called, can be very helpful with that additional confirmatory indicator. Charles Dow told us how important volume is to our analysis, but we don't need an extra histogram and additional tools on our chart. Instead, we've incorporated volume directly into the oscillator line. So when it's moving from this green into dark blue, that's where we're seeing heavy relative volume. The dark blue is our signal that there's enthusiastic market participation, either to the upside or the downside. And that incorporates an additional piece to our analysis without adding any clutter to our charts. So thank you very much for watching this. Hopefully this has been an educational tool for you. No matter what momentum tools you are using, hopefully you have a good understanding of how those are constructed and the way that you can interpret them, in particular with the interplay between price and momentum. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out to Alex and I, info@GoNoGoCharts.com. Thanks so much for watching. Be well, stay safe, and we'll see you soon.